Chris Horry, welcome to the BBC. You've actually been here before. You used to work here. You used to be.
That's right. I used to work for BBC News Online for quite a while.
And now you're a professor in journalism, and you've written a couple of books about BBC.
That's right. Down at the University of Winchester, which used to be the capital city of Denmark long ago. That's where Canute actually ran his empire from there. It's Danish territory, really, but we're occupying it at the moment.
I see. Okay, but just keep occupying. There's no problem for me. I'm not Danish. We saw Jimmy Savile here.
Yes.
He wasn't. These very serious allegations.
Hmm.
That was after he died last year.
Yes, that's right.
How come it wasn't before?
There's two levels to that. Now, it's always been known at an anecdotal level that Jimmy Savile was a man with all kinds of sexual interests. He came into the BBC from the world of dance halls way back in the 50s and 60s and pop promoting and the early days of discos and things like that. Mm. He was a man who had almost a monopoly on booking acts into working men's clubs and things like that all over the north of England. So when the BBC needed somebody to deal with something they didn't understand, pop music, he was just a big figure. He could book all the groups. Now, on one level, it's part of the groupie scene, you know, lots of... it was a very sexist kind of scene. There were no women rock stars or anything like that. It was a male-dominated scene. The groupie thing was going on, and people knew about that, and some people thought it was loathsome, but it went on. Of course, the second dimension to this, he was engaged in illegal activity of all sorts, and it seems that he was so invulnerable in his position in the BBC of just running the pop music side of things and booking the acts. Plus, he had lots of protection from tabloid exposés because the way in which the tabloids work with celebrity agents. So they would not necessarily want to drag somebody like Jimmy Savile through the mud. And if they were coming towards that, he would have all kinds of strategies to keep that out of the paper.
But would they know? Who would know?
The rumours were rife about him. But also here in England, I think, and Scandinavia as well, we have very, very severe libel laws. And the one thing typically a journalist cannot prove, unless they were in the room at the time, was any kind of sexual shenanigans. Even if Jimmy Savile had sex with somebody, a partner, including a legal partner, even if they complained about it, it's still the word of one person against another. Now, a newspaper, that's not good enough. If the police came in, as they did with Gary Glitter, and another star, and he's arrested and it goes to court and there's evidence and there's a conviction, then the papers can do it. But the libel laws here enable people like Jimmy Savile to shelter, and they say, well, you say that, but you try and prove it.
I see, but internally in the BBC, why didn't anyone stop this activity? I mean, it happened here in these very rooms.
I just don't know. Savile's position was so strong, and the lack of interest in light entertainment, pop music, and youth culture was so great in the organisation that he got away with murder.
But who knew?
After Savile's death and the Newsnight team in News and Current Affairs, the day after he died...
Yeah, Newsnight is a programme here in
I should
BBC.
Explain that there are two big BBC investigative journalism programmes, not just the day-to-day news, but programmes with the right to initiate stories, to dig into things. And the day that Savile died, Newsnight began gathering the evidence. But Savile died in October 2011. Newsnight began straight away preparing an expose as quickly as they could. But the entertainment division began basing their entire Christmas schedule around a big tribute to Jimmy Savile, who just died. It would have been a cheap programme to make because the BBC already owned all the footage and all the rest of it. When he died, there was quite a big kind of ceremony. I mean,
one department was wanted to celebrate him, and another department wanted to
turn him into a national hero.
And the other department
wanted
to scrutinise
him. Like a mini Diana. And the other side were going to kick him to death. Yeah. His reputation to death. And that's what the BBC absolutely failed to manage. Now, What made it even worse, what made it into an absolute car smash, was that they were indecisive. They could have said, well, we're just going to stick with our man Savile. That would have been a mad thing to do. And clearly, in an organised way, suppress the Newsnight thing. Or we're pulling the special, we're not going to do the special, we're going to change all our planning, even if it costs us millions, and we're going to go with Newsnight, which, of course, they should have done. They did neither. They prevaricated about it. They said, they told the investigative team to find more evidence, we're not sure yet, and all the rest of it. And eventually they suppressed it.
So the story wasn't told in BBC, it was told in the competing channel, ITV.
Yes, now, you're dealing with Newsnight with very ferocious investigative journalists. They are like dogs with a bone. Once they start on a story, nobody's going to shut them up. So
they were shut up, weren't they?
But they walked out across the road to the BBC's rival here, ITV, and ITV did the story immediately. And then...
So they actually tipped the...
Not only tipped off, the team went, or the key members of the team, and made the programme. You know, God bless democracy. There's one reason why we are happy countries. If one organisation is suppressing a story, you just walk over the road and the rivals will do it with enormous glee because, A, it's an important story which will get a big audience and it kicks the living daylights out of your rival, which is what the ITV has done to the BBC with this.
And then the BBC scandal was a fact.
Then there were these two dimensions, the question you've been asking. How did he persist for so long? And we don't know the answer to that yet. There's an inquiry still into it. Why were there all these rumours? And why didn't the press report it? You know, the News of the World, Rupert Murdoch's paper, week after week after week. Prince tittle-tattle about the sexual lives of all kinds of public figures. Here's more than tittle-tattle about somebody who was on television constantly through the 70s and 80s, Jimmy Savile. Not one but line about it.
Before,
what's a lesson we can learn from this?
Yes, that's what I wonder as well.
What do we learn?
Well,
sex sells.
Because but BBC is about trust. It's it's all about trust. It's like the Vatican. No, the wrong example. you know what I mean. Isn't that all they want?
The BBC is overmanaged. It has too many layers of bureaucrats whose only job is to look after their own backsides, quite frankly, and to say no. The BBC has lost confidence in its investigative journalists.
Can they restore it?
It will take a long time. This crisis is very, very serious because it goes to the heart of the trust in the BBC. The BBC is not the most sensational broadcaster. It's not the ratings chaser. It's not necessarily even the most first to break stories. But its whole reputation is on reliability. You can hear a story in Britain or perhaps even in Norway and you can check it and you can verify it with the BBC. When it's been on the BBC, you can take it to the bank. Any implication that the BBC has been suppressing news because it has a bad effect on the BBC itself, it's the sort of thing we would expect from the Murdoch organisation, to be frank. It's very, it's absolutely shaming for an ex-BBC journalist of myself to think that the BBC would have done this, suppress their own investigative work. Incredible.
Thank you very much for coming. Please welcome Marsha Gessen.